This meeting, please come to order. I believe we have a quorum. Okay, I understand there's another meeting at 6:30, Pension Board, so we want to move as quickly as we can. This special meeting is for the purpose of accepting the detailed explanation of costs that we asked for Attorney Lord. Do I hear a proposal to accept Andrew Lord's detailed expense explanation as outlined in his letter?
So moved.
We do. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Should we make a motion?
Tina and
Wally.
Wally. I usually sit there, but yeah. I'm up here.
So moved, Madam Chair.
Is there a second?
No, I'm not seconding.
Is there a second to the motion to accept Andrew Lord's detailed expense explanation as outlined in his letter?
Second.
Greg Kahn. All right, is there any discussion?
Chair Antezo, I have read the proposal. There are a number of issues I have with this. And, you know, one of the issues is that it looks like you already asked Mr. Lord to represent WPCA in connection with WPCA matters. But that's minor compared to my other issues. As I understand from the town attorney's office, the town attorney at our last meeting specified that they would be willing to hire for the town an attorney with specialization in these sorts of issues. The rate of pay for such an attorney would be $150 an hour. I'm sorry, I still have the floor. This attorney would be billing the town at $300 an hour. That $300 an hour also includes travel time from Old Saybrook. So it's feasible that if he were to be coming down for a meeting during rush hour in the winter, that just getting down here could take 2 hours. That would be $600. Getting back could be another hour. That's $900 plus more money for this. So I worry about, and then Mr. Lord also had said at our last meeting that he was willing to negotiate, but I'm not seeing any difference between what he first proposed and what I see in front of me now. So
I'd like to make a correction.
I'm sorry, I have the floor still. The other thing that I'm concerned about is that this board has authorized a consultant's report, and that consultant's report is exactly on governance. We haven't received that consultant's report. So we already have people doing research, experts doing research for us on governance issues. And I'm very eager to see that consultant's report before we do anything else with this. And lastly, my understanding is that Mr. Lord does not do litigation. So if for some reason we decided that we needed somebody who did litigation, we would have to start from square one with an attorney. So it's for those reasons that I have many concerns about this.
Okay, I'd like to just draw your attention to the fact that on November 14th, the town council approved the WPCA board's request to retain and reimburse a separate and independent legal counsel. It passed vote 8-2. The business about the $150 was actually aptly commented on by Vin Chase, because I drew attention to the fact that up to the 31st of October, town legal fees, pay, whatever you want to call it, that line item was $209,000. And Vin Chase made the correct comment that a specialist requires more money than $150. Also, for some reason, which I still don't understand, we still have two people, not one town lawyer, at $300 an hour at almost every one of our meetings. But that being said, we did pass that resolution on November 14th. It's in the minutes. Are there any other comments about or questions?
Ms. Yen?
Well, I'd like to find out if anybody else has an opinion or would like, Alan.
Yes, thank you. So Madam Chair, one of the questions I have is, as Beth stated, in the letter, it talks about him advising us, the WPCA, on statutory authority and governance issues. So we are getting that governance audit and report done. So I'm really having problems like fully understanding why we need him, especially since it's clear, even in the way Attorney Lord addresses his letter, it's addressed Town of Stratford Water Pollution Control Authority. The Water Pollution Control Authority is part of the overall Town of Stratford. So if there can't be any separation, we don't have the information from the audit report yet. I don't understand why this has to happen now.
Well, the fact that we've been at this since October, and the foot dragging is bothering me because we just are not, and we already hired him. I mean, we already passed a motion that we, the town council, approved our request to retain and reimburse a separate and independent council. This letter is for the details. As a matter of fact, Wally asked for
I believe that our last town council meeting, there was kind of three parts to that motion. There were three separate resolutions. The first resolution passed 8-2. The second resolution was stricken at the request of the town attorney,
right,
Mr. Hodgson. And the third item was tabled. It was not acted on.
Yeah, the third item, if you compare the motions, I was going to talk about that tonight, is actually a repetition of this with slightly different wording, which I didn't understand why we had to have it. The part that was stricken, I would have agreed with Attorney Hodgson's also, because it was trying to, one of them anyway in here, was trying to set how it was going to be paid through by a town council decision, which is not the way it's supposed to be. The WPCA is supposed to decide that. But anyway, we can get back to that part of it. Your question again had to do with the or management, for want of a better word. Believe it or not, the person who suggested to me that we get our own lawyer was the person who's doing the investigation, Ed Donahue. He said, you know, you people ought to have your own lawyer. What a concept. I think his report is going to be on current governance, and I believe that the future governance is what Attorney Lord is going to help us address.
Again, I just don't understand the speed of us having to create this new lawyer position. Open Pandora's box. He said at the last council meeting his billings are already at $3,000 or $4,000, and what has he done? He's basically already billing us for his travel time back and forth to and from Stratford.
I haven't received any bill yet, but if he does, we've been telling him to come and we diddle around with the vote. I mean, we have to make up our minds one way or the other, Phil.
Well, I think number one, it was Scott that brought up the fact that talking to him about how many hours he had come to the town council meetings and stuff like that, and that he wasn't actually billing us for those hours, but you made the comment that then, you know, we would have paid him that much if we had been on retainer at that point.
Yeah, it's what I said is we would have paid him. What would we have paid him for the hours he already spent here? But he did not say he was going to actually bill us for those hours.
And in terms of the audit coming out, I think that's going to be a very important thing. And I wouldn't mind having a person who's an expert at this be able to look at that audit and tell us what's good and what's wrong with it, you know, and who's can give us the expertise that we need, because we don't have that expertise. Remember, when we discussed some of the ideas of this thing, Mitzi, all the work that this guy is going to do has to go through Mitzi. She's the one who's going to approve it. We can terminate him at any time we'd like. We don't have to use him. It's not like he's part of the lawyer's staff, and you know that, so we might not even need to use him a lot. So that's up to our discretion. So So that's why I think it's an actual good idea to have a lawyer there who knows this stuff and is able to actually articulate where we're going with this.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
Also, the travel charge, what he said was an hourly charge. He did say he would negotiate that charge in the last meeting, but it's not necessarily that he's going to have to be here at every single one of our meetings.
That's true.
So that, excuse me, $300 travel charge, it might not even come into effect. And most meetings, he will not have to be here because he'll be dealing with you outside the meeting, and when you're addressing the concerns of the WPCA board, we'll be working through you to contact Attorney Lord. So I think that travel charge to me of what the argument is here is not very valid because he's not going to be here at every single meeting.
It can be mitigated.
That's very true.
What was that?
It can be mitigated anyhow.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Beth?
I just want to be clear about what it was that we passed. We were in the council meeting. It was saying that the town council acknowledges the WPCA board's authority to request and hire and reimburse a separate and independent legal counsel. That does not bind.
I'll read it to you. I'll read it, Beth.
I'm looking at the minutes here.
It's in the minutes.
Yeah.
It says, be it resolved that as specified under the authorities granted by the Connecticut General Statutes Chapter 103, Section 7-247A, the Town Council acknowledges the WPCA Board's authority to enter into contracts with any person and to make arrangements for the provision of staff services. Further, per criteria defined in the Charter, the Town Council acknowledges the WPCA Board's authority to request and hire and reimburse a separate and independent town legal counsel. As the town attorney's office has no preset limits or restrictions on the duration of assignments it receives from the town council also accepts the WPCA's board planned utilization of its separate and independent counsel. The town council hereby approves the WPCA board to request and retain and reimburse a separate and independent legal counsel. That's November 14th, town council minutes 8.1.
That's right, and that does not bind us in our position in this authority to hire this particular attorney.
Well, okay. Are there any other comments before we take a vote?
Hi. Sorry, I was running late from work. I just want to put on record that I have serious concerns regarding the interests of lawyers in this town, and that I believe that the waters are very muddy when it comes to which lawyers represent which things in this town. And with regards to counsel and our relationships with lawyers, I'm going to a Christmas party hosted by one of the town attorneys this week. I was invited. I think it becomes very muddy. I like the fact that Mr. Lord is from farther away and doesn't seem to be connected. I do like that. But I also think that it poses a conundrum for us with regards to who should be recusing, who shouldn't, and what kind of special interests are happening here. I think it really is not as transparent as we want it to be. I don't know if that means we need to wait, or if that means we need to vet this more, or if that just means it's not gonna happen because of that. I have no idea, but I think that there's just way too many ties to lawyers in this town.
Okay, I'm ready to take the vote. Alan.
One more comment, Madam Chairman. So after the special meeting that happened in October, there was an article that was in the Stratford Star in October 18th. And in it, one of the things it said is, it's not quite clear what Lord will do for Stratford, but his hire will help the WPCA separate itself from the town and the Public Works Department. The WPCA committee is comprised of the town council. 7th District Town Councilman Marianne Mitzi-Intezzo said she's hoping that the selection of an independent attorney will help the WPCA separate itself from the Public Works Department.
Well,
so one of the concerns is that as a WPCA, we're going to hire our own attorney and then use him as a legal means to separate certain portions and pieces of the WPCA's functionality from its current reporting tree. That's going to create additional layers of management, additional layers of bureaucracy. It's not something that I think we should be doing.
I don't think so, but as I walked the streets getting the no petition signed, a lot of people said to me, why don't we have something separate from the town council? Most towns do. They have a separate WPCA authority. You yourself said one time, you know, we should have an engineer on this. We should have more expertise, and I'd like to move in that direction, if possible. We'll see where it goes.
And okay, we don't need outside attorneys to write up and create ordinances and create the separation of the WPCA from the town council. We have means of doing that. We know how to do it. We've been going through those machinations for the last year. This isn't our first month here, although I will acknowledge that Mr. Kahn and Mr. Farrington-Posner are newer, but the rest of us have been here for a while and have seen how things function, and I don't think we need to have our hand held by a $300 an hour attorney.
Okay, that's your opinion. All right, let's vote. All those in favor, say aye.
Roll call. Roll call.
Roll call. Beth?
I vote no for hiring this particular attorney at this time.
I vote yes.
No.
Yes.
Yes.
No.
No.
Yes.
Yes.
Motion passes.
Motion. No, the motion fails.
Why?
Does it pass?
It's five to four. At simple majority. Motion passes.
Motion passed. Do I hear a call for adjournment?
Second.
So move.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Hey, you'll make the pension board.
Because remember last time.
Hey, thank you very much. Welcome to the public forum, December 12th, 2016. We have a number of people who want to speak, which means that each person will have 3 minutes and only 3 minutes to speak. So our first speaker is Mr. Jim Feehan, Chair of the Board of Education.
Madam Chairman, Jim Feehan, 930 Beaver Dam Road, Stratford, current Chairman of the Board of Education, former Councilman of the 9th, former Council Chairman. As I've sat in your chairs, as I said last time I was here to speak, I know the hard decisions that you have to make many a time. Well, tonight, you're faced again with that hard decision I asked you to make a year ago. I asked you to take a look at giving the children and the community what it needs, and that is a new field house is what I'm speaking about, and I'm sure it was no surprise to anyone. But what the surprise is how we have not acted on this already. We had asked, the mayor's office to make bricks without any straw. He did that. He found money through other projects that hadn't been completed, leftover money, and cobbled money together, and then also some that was already being put away from the CIP. And for that, I give the mayor credit. But then we fell short. We went out for bid 3 times on this project, $1.2 million. We got it down a little bit less to around 1.1. This project falls under prevailing wage. We can't get it any other lower than that. I even went to the Alumni Association and asked them if they would be able to help. And you'll see them tonight. Bobby's here, one of my good friends. We found a way that we could do this. However, it would take the council to waive all bidding laws and fund a non-entity of alumni to be able to do the project within the prevailing wage scale, which I don't think is a proper thing to do with community money, but I think it's proper to do for the community. At the end of the day, we can't change the factors. 3 times out for bid, we've whittled the project down as low as we can go, and yet we're still at the same place. Where are we at? We're creating a divide once again in Stratford, where it's okay for one section of town and not okay for another section of town. And that's not the right way. At the Board of Ed, I'm in charge of every student, no matter where they are from this town. You as councilmen have to be for everyone in every part of the town. And let me clarify something. There are some people that say, that's going to be for that side of town. It's not. We bus children to every school. Mr. Posner, you can attest to that because we've spoken about that, I believe, on Facebook. And we do that for a reason. Stratford is roughly right now 50% minority population, which is truly representative of the United States of America. And we believe it's right that students not have one particular school where one set of students goes and another student goes to another set. We believe in having a proper racial mix. So what that means is that there are children from District 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, who in the past used to go to Stratford High, now go to Bunnell. We mix our two high schools together, and they educate together. So it serves everyone in town. Pop Warner, Cavalcade of Bands, every sport, the SWC. And the last thing I'll give you to cut off my time, Madam Chair, because I do respect that you gave me this much, is the following, the history. The Bunnell Fieldhouse was never paid for by the town. It was originally but raised by donation. While, on the other hand, Pender's Field was provided from the town. But here's the coup de grace with this. The one down at Pender's needed renovation. The one at Pender's was done, I believe, 8 years after Bunnell was done. It's already had a renovation. Bunnell has never had one, and the renovation was paid for by the town. How is that fair to that school? It's not. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you very much. And may the record show that as Mr. Feehan was speaking, there were a number of people holding signs in support. I saw seven from this vantage point. Yeah. Okay. Oh, nine. Okay, thank you. The next speaker is Eric Hampton. And all speakers, I just want to remind you, you have to say your name and address.
Yes, good evening. My name is Eric Hampton. About a year and a half ago, I approached Mayor Harkins. I worked for the state of Connecticut. I spent 22 years in the Department of Economic and Community Development. My background is in finance. I'm a financial analyst, and I just retired in May. A couple of projects here that I'm proud to say I participated in Stratford, two roads, Hubble water heaters, and Stratton. I approached the mayor about the redevelopment agency. I have skills and expertise, again, not to be redundant, 22 years at the state level. It would be my honor if you would consider me for the open position on the agency. Thank you. Good evening.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hampton. We have your address down as 1565 Huntington Road. Is that correct? Okay, thank you very much. Next speaker is Bob Jekyll.
I don't know if I can hold it here, but my name's Bob Jekyll, 175 Twin Oaks Terrace, so I don't get asked to say that again. Going back a few years, in September of 1986, I was actually a freshman at Bunnell High School, and we all got to admire the brand new field house that was just built with donations of time, efforts, and monies from families who cared about the Bunnell Athletic and Musical Program, as well as the many other programs in town that would use the facility for years to come. Since that time, which is over three decades ago, town spent $30,000 to help tap into the electrical that was happening with the electrical work that was being done there as well as the field. It has not spent a penny on it since. That was over three decades ago, and after decades of decay and significant wear and tear that it has taken because of its year-round use, it is impossible to count on donations again, not only because we can't do that these days, but there are significant regulations, environmental studies, prevailing wage, material costs, whatever you want to have, that just is the fact of how things get done now. That being the case, in comparison, we have a field house across town that some Mr. Feehan already pointed out. The town has spent $1.6 million on a football-only field house and restoring it since it was built after the one at Bunnell. And I'm not just saying this because now I have sons that go there, play sports there, and I enjoy frequenting it to watch them participate in their activities, but fair is fair. Every one of you have kids in your districts, constituents of yours. It's not just adults that are your constituents, it's kids too. Every district has kids that go to Bunnell, participate in some activities that use that field, whether it's Pop Warner or they're involved in some kind of musical event. All of you have kids in those districts that participate at that field. What are you doing to help them? You are elected to help them as well. So I just ask you to do all the right thing, and when your chance comes, to do the right things for the kids of this town, not just the ones that go to that school, but the ones that will use that facility, just as you did the kids that use the facility at Pender's, do the right thing. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Next speaker is Max Jekyll. And again, say your name and your address, please, when you approach a podium.
Hello, hello. My name's Max Jekyll, 175 Twin Oaks Terrace. I'm a junior at Bunnell High School, and I also play for the soccer team. I'm here because I'm asking of you to fund the rest of the money needed for our field house. A field house should be a place that represents Bunnell athletics in a positive manner, and our fails to do so. There is graffiti on the roof of our field house, giving Bunnell a bad reputation. For the past year and a half, the field house has been without a water fountain, leaving spectators of games and players without water thirsty. And on top of that, the boys' bathroom does not have a door on one of the stalls, which is completely inappropriate as people are trying to use the bathroom. They are exposed to everyone else. As the teenagers at Bunnell High School, we trust the adults to do the right thing. Please fund our field house. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. The next person is Cody McCraner.
Good evening. My name is Cody McCraner, and I live at 98 Temple Street in Stratford, Connecticut. I play for the Bunnell High School soccer team, and I'm the starting varsity goalkeeper. And I wanted to bring to your attention our need for a new field house. Well, we've had the field house for about 30 years, and that's 3 decades, and it's quite a long time. In the boys' bathroom, the tiles on the ground are cracked and broken, and they look very bad. It's pretty disgusting in there. It's kind of hard to go to the bathroom. The locks are broken in the locker rooms, which is only for football. I've heard a lot from the football players about that. As a player, a new field house would greatly increase my self-esteem and dignity to know that I'm being given a voice in this town from the leaders, because I'm not gonna go and take down the field house and build it myself. I can't do that. And as teenagers, we trust that the leaders and the elders of this town will do the right thing and get it done, please. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'm sorry. Okay. Mr. McCraner, could you repeat your address, please? Temple Street. Okay, thank you very much. Next speaker is Quentin Goodman.
Hello, my name is Quentin Goodman, and I live at 5029 Main Street, Stratford. And I'm here on behalf of the new field house for Bunnell, and I served as captain of the Bunnell soccer team this season, and I would love a new field house. The one we have now is 30 years old, and the stalls of the bathroom door are non-existent. And there's no water fountain, which is horrible for the players, considering they have to bring their own water. And it was there before, but now it's gone, so yeah. And ever since I was a freshman, I've known that the soccer team needed a locker room to call their own. And going into my senior year, I'd love to see this dream of mine fulfilled. And moving on from high school is a bittersweet time, and the addition of a new field house would make this experience 10 times better. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next speaker is Jack Spillane.
Hello, I'm Jack Spillane. I live on 401 Bridgeview Place, and I'm here for the same reason as them. My main point is we have one field house, but four fall sports teams, and only one uses it, which is football. So during our soccer games, we, like, there's no use for it. We have to bring all our stuff onto the field, and at halftime, we have to sit in the corner of the field in the cold, and yeah, it's really beat up. That's about it.
Okay, thank you very much for coming out. The next speaker is John Rich.
John Rich, 68 Willow Avenue. I'm also a member of the Parks and Recreation Committee. Happy holidays and Merry Christmas to everyone. I don't know about you, but I know I've spent many a holiday evening till 2, sometimes 3 in the morning, trying to figure out how slot A fits into tab B as I'm putting together some toy for my children. It doesn't always work out the first time. And the reason I say that is because I know that there has been some degree of strong pushback about a project that I believe in, which is the skating rink. Yes, the skating rink, as it's gone up, seems to have issues. That it's not necessarily level like it should be. There's problems with the water as it came out of the hydrant. There are always bumps in the road. It's the ability to respond to those bumps in the road and make the appropriate changes, repairs, to make a project successful for it to go on. How many bumps have you seen, Mr. Llewellyn, in trying to do what you need to do over at Stratford High School? Now, the thing about it is we have a councilman in the district who has already started to consider those bumps. At the last meeting of the Longbrook Park Commission, Mr. Farrington Posner actually proposed and is in the process of setting up a subcommittee that is going to oversee the skating rink. He recognizes that there are going to be issues that are going to be discovered as the process continues that need to be addressed, need to be dealt with. From simple things like hours of operation to the more complex things like possible repairs that might be needed from season to season. So let's take a step back, let's take our time, let's get our public officials, who I have faith in, to resolve these issues, and let's have something successful for the residents of Stratford. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rich. The next person is Mark Giuliano. Commissioner Giuliano.
Good evening, Madam Chair. Mark Giuliano, 78 Kathleen Drive. I'd like to reiterate, but it's hard to follow this good act that we have here on the field house at Bunnell. I'm a former alumni of 42 years. That field house is 31 years, and I've been a building trades journeyman for over 40 years, so basically part of that building is tired. It definitely needs to be some work done on it, or whatever it is that is up. I haven't seen, don't know about the plans for it, but it definitely could use it. I'm sure of that. The other thing is, and I just want to make it short and sweet, on the WPCA, I really think that's the right road to go down with Attorney Lords. So you guys have a great holiday and Merry Christmas to you all.
Thank you very much. Next person is Coach Bob Mastroni.
Good evening. Bob Mastroni, 1432 Main Street. I was a football coach at Bunnell High School for 24 years, so I know something about the field house and how it's used. What was it like before there was a field house there? Well, what happened was We would dress in the gymnasium, and we'd come down to the field. Now, that meant that we had to go back to the gymnasium when practice was over. But what about if kids had to go to the bathroom? And they had to go back up the hill to go to the bathroom. It was very inconvenient. We had to carry our equipment down from the garage. We had to bring it back every night. During the football games, at halftime of a football game, we would have to go up to the field house to a garage and then come back down. Sometimes it would take 10 minutes, and we only had 15 minutes at halftime. It didn't give us much time to talk to our players. So it was an extremely inconvenient way to do things without a field house. Then the field house was built, and we had a new life. We had a place that we can call a home, and it was a home to us, and we treated it like a home. We protected it, we took care of it, we made sure it was clean. Now we had a place that our kids could change in, and we had bathrooms available to us. We had a place at halftime next to the field. It was a wonderful, wonderful thing. And I'm talking about just the sport of football, what it meant to us to have that field house available to us. We loved it. We would show our game films in there. We'd talk to players. We'd have meetings in there. And we had a wonderful time because of that field house. So I'm a fan of the field house. Done a lot for football. And I would compare it to saying, without a field house would be like trying to teach a class without giving them a classroom. And so I thank you for the time tonight, and I wish you well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Coach. Next person to speak is Dan Senft.
Good evening. Dan Senft, 235 Old Coach Lane. I'm a member of the Building Needs Committee. I'm a former student athlete at Pinnell, former coach with Bob Mastroni, and former president of the Bulldog Club, where we were able to raise some considerable amount of money to help facilitate and keep the upkeep of the field house, besides the lights and various other items. Obviously, you know from some of you that are on the Building Needs Committee, the last several months we've been discussing this. It's been talked about at a considerable length. I think at this particular point we need to move forward. It comes with a favorable recommendation from the Building Needs Committee. I provided you each with the history of the field house, as well as some drawings from the architect, and we're just looking for your approval tonight. So I thank you for your time, and hope everybody has a great holiday. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dan. The next person is Bob DiLorenzo.
Thank you, everyone. It's Bob DiLorenzo, 185 Shepherd Street, Stratford, Connecticut. I'd like to speak on the pride and tradition of what's going on here tonight. So, well, it's hard to match Mr. Feehan and my coach Mastroni and my coach Senft. And there's just a lot of history and tradition in here of what we're trying to accomplish. And if you see my shirt tonight, I wore it because it says one thing. It says 100% effort. And that's the way I was raised with the program and where I've come from in the town of Stratford. I've been a proud resident of this town for over 31 years. And tonight, you know, again, you know, Coach Mastroni, it's always hard to follow him, but, you know, tonight I'm lucky enough to coach a freshman team at Bunnell. And a lot of times when I go down to the school, I see Mr. Poison and I see Bob Jekyll and I see the soccer team and I see the band, I see lacrosse, I see and Pop Warner on Sunday mornings. And the usage of the field house in a new facility is going to be very, very good, and it will last the next 30 to 35, 40 years, just like the first one did. As I point over to my crew right here, mostly all my linemen showed up, which I'm impressive with, but it's great. So before you, you know, I just ask, I think, you know, all of you guys have been, you know, most of the contact I've had with everybody, and I'd like to thank mostly everyone most recently for putting some patchwork to the field house this past September that helped Mr. Petrucci and Mr. Feehan and Clarence and so forth that put the patchwork. But we need to move forward, and I think that if we follow the program, the pride and tradition of the program and the town, because it does benefit the town, and we give 100% effort in what we're doing, we can make it happen. So that's all I have to say. I thank you, and I wish you all a very happy holiday. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Next person is Chris Chucci. Did I say your name right? Yes. Wow.
Thank you. Chris Chucci, 140 Longview Drive, Stratford. While they're not going to speak tonight, I'm here with some members of the Benalla Girls soccer team. So my comments will be brief. I simply came down tonight to ask the mayor and the town council to make the Benalla Fieldhouse renovation project a priority. While I don't think the project is being ignored, I don't think it's getting quite the attention it deserves, and possibly getting lost in the bureaucracy of municipal government. I know how that works sometimes. But bottom line is the students and the athletes deserve better, the parents using that facility deserve better, and the residents of the town of Stratford deserve better. So to kind of use a football analogy, you know, we need you to serve as the offensive line to push the pile forward, to clear the path, and move this project over the goal line, and make it happen. So I hope you'll do so. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next person is Jaden Chuma.
Hello, my name is Jaden Chuma. I live on 34 Bates Street. I'm a freshman at Benalla High School, and I play football. I'm here on behalf of fixing our field house and my coach Bob. And I believe we need to fix our field house because one of the days when we first came, some people had to share lockers because our lockers are jammed and broken in and beaten in. And like, it's sad because like, we need this stuff, we need equipment. Some people had to bring their equipment home and bring it all the way back, carry it around in school. And I believe that the town of Stratford can help us fix our field house. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next person is Vincent Course.
Hello, I'm Vincent Course, 30 Mercer Street, Stratford, Connecticut. I'm going to be repetitive because there are problems, but I'm in the football team and the band, and when other bands come for competitions, it's like represents how we are. And if they come and use the bathrooms and the bathrooms are run down, it sort of shows what Benalla really is. And it's not good showing of how we are. The graffiti in the rooms too is bad. And then when other schools come for football games, it shows how we really are and how we treat, how we try and treat our stuff. But then it just, like, it gets old and stuff and it runs down. It shows how Benalla really is. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next person is Michael Dottola, or Dottora. Dottora?
I'm Michael Dottoro. I live on 615 North Johnson Lane, and I'm part of the football team. And I think that our field house is very awful, and we deserve a new one. And I hope you can do that.
Okay, thank you. I'll ask him. Mr. Dottora, could you repeat your address, please? We didn't catch.
North Johnson?
Okay, thank you. The next person is Gerald Gray. Is Gerald Gray present? No? Okay. Then. Next person is Linda Palermo.
Linda Palermo, 46 Clock Place, Stratford. I would like to speak with regard to legislation I understand is taking place in Hartford that has to do with mediation regarding foreclosures on homes. I live in a COA, as many of us do in the 5th District. I wish that they would join hands with the people from Stratford that do not have an opportunity to have mediation, because it's just a word on a court calendar. It means absolutely nothing. We are having a lot of problems in Stony Brook. I, for one, have one. I don't owe them any money. They're trying to take me to court. They're going to have problems. But nevertheless, we've got to do what's right for all, not just a select few. So therefore, I would ask that any state legislator please work forward and see if we could include cooperatives in that bargaining unit, because we're not there, but yet we pay a lot of taxes to this town. I hope my 5th District councilman listens with tender ear. With regard to Bunnell High School, I've been hearing about this year upon year upon year. All I have to say is, let's give them what they need. Let's give them what they want. We have taxes in town. Let's go for it. Let's not play games with the kids. I always say, what we have for children turn up to be adults, and they will remember, and we have to respect what they want as well. Well, it's my startling comment. One of the things I find in Stony Brook, when these people get to court, and I think it's disgusting, they treat us with double jeopardy. We'll make a payment arrangement, we try to keep up with the payment arrangement, and then you'll hear in a court document, go to foreclosure. You can only have it one way, as far as I'm concerned. We're not felons. We do have a right to live as well, and I think that should be looked into. Okay. I also read in a court document, an affidavit not too long ago. I read, it was an affidavit, so the person swears to it. They knock 6 judges, 4 attorneys, the Stratford Police Department, and the Bridgeport Police Department. Well, what I have to say is, let's thank God we have a police department that is there and concerned for our safety and well-being. Let's not close those doors to them. I know when I call and I'm being given a hard time, I'll say, excuse me, I said, are you going to take my complaint or what? And they go, yes, Mrs. Palermo, we will take that complaint. So what I have to say at this juncture is, to all those officers out there, their families and their children, our fire department, their families and their children, the council that sits here, your families and your children, all the people that sit out here, I say this, have a very Merry Christmas, and that's a good night. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Palermo. Okay, the next, Ms. Gerald Gray, please.
Good evening, Gerald Gray of 29 Shoreline Drive, Stratford. I'm on a little different note tonight than what's preceded me. As you all know, I've been coming before you at these monthly town council meetings, public forums, since this past spring. I have mostly focused upon the context of the terrible abuse and loss that my mother, Dolores Gray, and I have personally suffered per and via the horrific predatory actions that have been perpetrated upon us by the machine of power-owning interested parties that hold political and public service positions in the town of Stratford, and or whom are also town of Stratford residents holding power and position at state of Connecticut level. The horrific abuse that my mother and I have been and are being subjected to has revealed some truly putrid contents under the facade of this town, of this county, and this state, which is now infamously nationally known as Corruptica. a state that is now justifiably ranked as the number one state out of all 50 from which its residents are fleeing to relocate to other states. I speak of ugly truths at these town council meetings, even as I am met with silence and non-response, even as people come to me later and remind me that none of the town council cares about what I am saying, that the politics and agendas of this town are deeply and strongly entrenched in corrupt cronyism. They say that what George Mulligan spoke is true, this being that the two political parties here are no different from each other, as they equally serve the vested interests and agendas of their own. They do not serve the interests and well-being of the people of Stratford, regardless of which political party these power wielders are members. Speaking of George Mulligan, I became acquainted with him back several years via reading his letters to the Stratford Star. I did not particularly enjoy his energetic verbal gymnastics, but I saw that the expository information he was putting out to us was so valid, and I saw that he was virtually the only one saying these things, the only one saying that the Emperor has no clothes here in Stratford. George is our own Mark Twain treasure. I became personally acquainted with him when I began coming regularly to these town council meetings and heard him speak. George Mulligan was providing, through his letters to the Star and his public speaking, the only voice exposing what dirty stuff Stratford politics can be made of. I have tried to do the same with the truth I am experiencing and learning of. I repeatedly, myself, have sent letters to the editor of the Star. Only one, it being pretty generically bland in content, was published just a few months back. In it, I spoke to the fact that I was the only member of the public attending a multitude of the meetings of the many commissions and agencies of town of Stratford, and that this was not a good thing, that people of Stratford were not present, aware, and participatory in knowing what is being done to them by this town through these power holders. In looking at the town expenditures, I saw that both the Star and the Connecticut Post get tens of thousands of dollars from town of Stratford for their publications of town notices and ads. I realized that it is not in the financial interest of these two publications to bite the hands that feed them, so it is not so advantageous for mine or George's expository letters to get published. Again, speaking of George, I missed his presence at these last two meetings and missed his letters. None have been published in the Star lately. I contacted him, he informed me that the Star has not been publishing his letters, which he still weekly submits, as they have been similarly touched on the topic of corruption in Stratford, specifically along the lines of which I have been doing.
Okay, thank you. If you could finish up, please.
Okay. He is becoming more likewise attitude of the futility of his bothering to speak at these town council meetings. Loss of Georgia's swamp muck raking is a big loss. Thank you.
Thank you. The next person to speak is Mark Scheck.
Mark Scheck, 161 Birdseye Street. So, easy stuff tonight.
Easy enough. Can you guys hear me? It's too much.
No, it's fine.
So, I'm on the committee for PAC 74 and Lordship. We're doing great things down there. Actually, Bob Jekyll with Sea Scouts doing some really good things. So finally, some good things. Oh, by the way, Merry Christmas, Happy Birthday, and get these kids a field house. Just get it done. So the other thing is, PAC 74, we're doing some great things with Sea Scouts. This spring will be awesome. There's a couple of PACs that folded within town, actually in District 2. So if we could get any children that want to be scouts, just reach out to us. I think everybody knows how to reach me. And I think that's it. Merry Christmas.
Okay, thank you very much.
All right. There's other stuff, but no one wants to hear.
I'm sorry? The next speaker is Walter Rimkunis. Can you get the sheet? Thank you. Mr. Rimkunis. Is somebody breathing hard? Okay. That's
good evening. Welcome.
work. Is it working?
Okay.
Yay.
Let's try again.
Reboot.
What?
You're going to give him the broken mic, Tina?
Tina, are there any others? There's another sheet. Can you grab the other sheet, please?
Yeah, the popping went away. That was pleasant. I mean, thank you.
Yeah, but with the kids, it's tough. Okay, thank you everybody. I'm just, Mr. Vinkunas.
Well, he's still playing there. What's that?
Yep, you're mic'd.
Okay, let's try it again. I won't touch the podium. Walter P. Vinkunas, 425 Second Avenue, longer than you people have been born, except for Mitzi. We've been together. We graduated grade school together.
Where was that?
St. Charles. In Bridgeport. Harding High School.
Okay.
How about that? 1948. Okay, let's try it. I'm here fighting. You got the football team, the soccer team. You missed the basketball, well, they don't, but the lacrosse team isn't there.
Excuse me.
But no, but you got them all. I utilized that field for 16 years as a Pop Warner coach. We used it on Sunday. Just to clarify something, everybody come down, we got football there every Sunday. But the rest of the week, where does Pop Warner practice? Pender's Field. So that doesn't cut anything one way or the other. I'm not knocking this project. I am just curious. When I first started hearing about this project before the last council people left, it was rushed through on a blank piece of paper.
Then they came up with a hand-drawn, and it was $200,000. Then it went to $600,000. Now, we were up to $100.4 million. We're down to $1.1 million. I don't know what the heck they added to it, what kind of tiles they're putting on the floor or whatever. But I won't knock it. If it's going to help things here in town, make a little better between the two sides, north and south, I'm for it. Number two, I am not against progress within the town. But I just don't like this business of our center of our town. It's becoming a bunch of brick. You've got over there down on Stratford and Main Street. You got the one over there Christ Church is going to build. You got the one over at Ferry Boulevard, 72 million, 72. And I see there's another one on the zoning commission for 133. Where in heck is all this going? Oh, we're going to, the center of town is going to look like a bunch of brick on that. And then I haven't seen the complete thing of AFCO. They want to still go up to 8 stories over there with the big hotel they want to build down there. When do we say, let's stop and look at this? Can our schools, I said it before, can our schools handle this? Can the WPCA handle all that is coming through? Are we equipped for it? I think it's somebody's time for us to step back one, take a breath, and think about it. Not just go willy-nilly because this one or that one or whatever favors us. No more of this Stratford High School or Bunnell High School drama clubs. Let's, you responsible people, think about what is going on, please.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Rimkunis. Next speaker is Bruce Claxton.
Hello, I'm Bruce Claxton. I live at 1100 South Avenue. Being a part of the freshman football team is one of the amazing things about being in high school. And I feel the field house should be one of those good feelings, but it's not because it's just so run down with the graffiti and the bathrooms, and the locker rooms are just tight. Saturday mornings at JV games, when I'm in there and I'm noticing when they have their shoulder pads on, people are standing up, and that's not how it should be when the coach is talking. Everyone should be sitting down, listening to coach, and some people have to stand up. And like most of the speakers tonight said, I played for Pop Warner for 7 to 8 years, and we used to go in there on Saturday, and it was just one of the best things ever, but it was run down. And I was like, wow, I hope it's not like this when I go to high school, and it is. And it's just, it's not a good feeling when we're at a home game and like it's run down, and like my other teammate said, the lockers are small and people have to take their equipment home, and it's just, it's not a good feeling. And we hope that we can look to you to fix our field house to make sure that we can feel good about it someday before we graduate. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Claxton. And the last speaker evening is Thomas Yem.
I didn't get his address. Can you tell me?
It is 1100 South Avenue.
Thank you.
Mr. Yem?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thomas Yem, 746 Broad Street. A couple of quick notes. I want to mention in this hall that on January 4th, there's a transportation-oriented development meeting picking up from the November 9th meeting. This one will be at Baldwin at 6 p.m., January 4th. I also want to congratulate the members of the WPCA committee for their action tonight. And I want to give out a shout out to the Stratford Star tweet department. Those of you who are not familiar with Twitter, and I'm not terribly familiar with it, the fact is, if you're sitting at home tonight and you go to Twitter and connect with the Stratford Star, you can get Melvin's tweets on any given meeting night and get a running commentary on what's going on. It's very, very helpful. The only thing better might be a live feed of the whole shebang. All right, my remarks tonight. Yes, that's weeks later. That's also good too.
Mr. Yem?
I was trying to be generous. All right, I want to speak to agenda item 5.2.3 tonight. That's the Shakespeare Subcommittee report. I serve on this subcommittee, and this committee has met regularly for more than 6 months. It's a very serious group, very dedicated to re-engaging the project of revitalizing the Shakespeare Theater. I hope when council takes up this matter tonight that members will seriously consider how this town may best proceed with securing and cleaning the long-neglected building. And as part of your consideration, I hope you will reach out to those with real-world experience in restoring historic theaters. One such individual is in Town Hall tonight, as it turns out, she is a member of the Elm Street Theater Company, which has recently completed or nearly completed full renovations of a theater, an historic theater in Norwalk. Her name is Suzanne Cahill. And I'm certain that if any one of you council members asks Suzanne to speak about the economics of historic building theater revitalization, including tax credits and expenditures, et cetera, she will be happy to address your questions. I hope you'll consider that tonight. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Yem. And that ends the evening's public forum. I wish all of you a happy holidays. The council meeting starts at 8 p.m.